A very good afternoon to each one of you present here. Today I, Smriti Bali, on behalf of Delhi Metropolitan Education Noida, would like to extend a hearty welcome to our guest, Professor Dr. Tarun Arora Sir, Dean, School of Legal Studies, Central University, Punjab. Further, I would like to extend my warm regards to Professor Dr. Ravikant Swami Sir, Director, DME Noida, Professor Dr. N.K. Behel Sir, Dean, DME Noida, Professor Dr. Bhavish Gupta Sir, Head of Academics, DME Noida, Ms. Navjot Suri Ma'am, Assistant Professor Law, DME Noida, and all the faculties and students for being with us today. Today, we have a webinar in conversation with Professor Dr. Tarun Arora Sir. Sir holds 19 years plus of teaching experience and has specialization in jurisprudence, constitutional law, environmental law, biological diversity law. Further, Sir has written 2 books on environmental law and business law and has 54 research papers published in his name. Sir has been honored on Law Day by International Council of Jurists on November 26, 2008 by Lord Justice Philip, House of Lords, UK, and the Government of Punjab on August 15, 2014 for his valuable contribution in the field of environmental awareness. And the list of Sir's valuable contribution goes on. Now, without any further delay, I would like to invite our guest to share his valuable thoughts with all of us. I welcome you, sir, and it is indeed our pleasure to have you with us today. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Smriti. And first of all, I would like to extend the greetings on behalf of our Karambhumi Central University of Punjab, Bathinda. And I wish healthy and safe time for all of the participants and students as well as stakeholders of DME.
Thank you.
I am grateful to Dr. Shri Ravikant Swamiji, who is and Dean, and Dr. N.K. Behel, Shri Bhavesh Gupta Ji, Shri Kush Kalada, who is my friend, and Madam Suri. So I am grateful to you all for associating me with the DME family. And so I have been, means a kind of a assignment given by Kush that to have a kind of introductory session on environmental jurisprudence, environmental laws, and much more thing is covered within the domain of environmental jurisprudence. So before we take off, I wish to make 2 disclaimers. I usually make in my public lectures. First is, all of you can understand the domain of this topic, environmental jurisprudence. So the scope, the nature is too wide. And since I, if I'm not wrong, I have been given about total 45 to 55 minutes covering, where I have also to give opportunity to the students, participants for hearing and interaction. Certainly, so 10 to 15 minutes I will reserve for them. And so the disclaimer is, the discussion which we will be going to make, that is not exhaustive, that is inclusive. Fine. And for this purpose, I have shared my email ID. And the students, the participants who are listening to me, they can drop any query, observation, comment, question to me on this email ID. And the second disclaimer is that the views which are being presented in this presentation, these views are not political, and there is no need to politicize, because these views have been drawn, if anything comes, that is on the basis of research, findings, and observations drawn out of the research study. So being a student of constitutional law, being a student of jurisprudence, so those observations are drawn. So no political ideology is being represented. And therefore, the inputs, the discussion has to be construed in the light of the studies only and being a researcher. So friends, so far as environmental jurisprudence is concerned,
yes, sir. Yeah, I'll just. Is it fine, sir, now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
So the purpose of this interaction and selection of this topic is to sensitize the participants about environmental jurisprudence and to develop their understanding on the evolution of modern environmental jurisprudence, that how did it evolve and how international environmental law is concerned with national environmental law. What is the interrelationship between international environmental law and national environmental law? And then, since we are discussing jurisprudence and there are three sources of emergence of law, origin of law are discussed in jurisprudence. So what had been the role of values-based custom, precedents, and legislations in the development of environmental jurisprudence? So friends, so far as development of international environmental law is concerned, I wish to know that whether it is an interactive session, can I interact with the students or should I go one time first?
Yes, sir. Definitely, you can interact with the students. That will be very lively.
Fine, sir.
Yes,
so,
sir.
So, friends, I would like to know, what do you feel that international environmental law, had it been taught or discussed during the period of 90s to 1950, what would have been the better title, better nomenclature of this subject? Is there any guess?
Students, I have unmuted. You can unmute yourself and open the video as well. And you can ask the questions and also interact with sir. Let us have an interactive session. So I'll request all the students to kindly open the video and unmute yourself.
Thank you, ma'am.
Please repeat the question if possible.
Yeah, sure. My question is, if the same subject is being discussed during the period of 1900 to 1950, 1900 से लेके 1950 तक अगर हम इस subject को discuss करते, what would have been the better title, better nomenclature? For this subject, because we usually call it international environmental law, and whether the same title can be continued in post 1990 era, 1990 के बाद international environmental law, is it justifiable for us, or should we go for any other variation? Fine. So let me share my views, that what I feel that when we look at the emergence of international environmental law, and if we look at the case I had shown on your screen, that title of the case is displayed, Bering Sea arbitration case, that is North Pacific Fur Seals case 1893. Friends, the case indicate how the conservation practices under international environmental law. But please mind that at that time, in 1890, the international law itself has not developed. If we talk about public international law, that developed after 1920, after the First World War, and then after Second World War, it came into the form of establishment of United Nations Charter. And had we been discussing this subject in 1950, the better title would have been international conservation law. International conservation law. I would justify that why it needs to be addressed as international conservation law had this subject been taught about 100 years back. There are many treaties which we will discuss, and then comes, if we look at the development of international environmental law, I would like to introduce the student with this trail smelters arbitration phenomena between United States and Canada. That is transboundary pollution. And then comes United Nations Conference of Human Environment, 1972, UNEP, United Nations Environment Program, 1982, then Rio Declaration, which is also known as United Nations Conference on Environment and Development. And it is followed by World Summit on Sustainable Development, 2002, in this new millennium. Then comes Rio Plus 20, means in 2012, we celebrated 20th year of Rio Declaration 1992. Unfortunately, if we look at the results of Rio 2012, those were not as expected. Therefore, in 2015, we had a supplementary program that is called Paris 2015. So friends, now to explain all these points, Bering Sea arbitration case is based on the four treaties between Russia and US. The first treaty was entered into between the country of Russia and United States, that is regarding Bering Sea arbitration, Bering Sea. If you have ever looked at the globe, and there is a bay between United States and Russia, Alaska and Russia. And at that time, in 1824, a treaty was entered into between the two nations, United States and Russia. And then it was modified between Russia and United Kingdom for the purpose of commercialization of the marine mammals, for hunting marine mammals. And those mammals were the part of UK's economic practices. And in 1890, three ships of United Kingdom, who was the licensee in that Bering Sea Bay, three ships of United Kingdom were confiscated by United States. The purpose of this confiscation was to conserve the marine mammals. But unfortunately, United States, in order to protect marine mammals, intruded in the open seas and the rights of another sovereign country. Let me remind, rights of another sovereign power, United Kingdom, these rights were intruded, and they were in fact carrying out their marine activities in the open seas as a licensee in agreement with Russia. And now what United States did, they confiscated their three ships. And the matter, at that time, we did not have any international court of justice or international criminal court. Therefore, the arbitration tribunal was constituted. And United States pleaded that if at this extent, these marine activities are allowed to continue, these will put the marine mammals, the species of fish, those will on the verge of extinction. Therefore, we have confiscated their ships. But United Kingdom pleaded before the arbitration tribunal that whatever is their objective, they cannot intrude into the sovereign affairs of another state. From here, the doctrine of sovereignty emerged. And in the wake of doctrines of sovereignty, trial smelters arbitration case that was filed by United States against Canada on the border, in the border states of Canada, mining operations were going on during 30s. And due to those mining operations and smelting operations, the suspended particulate matters, those created transboundary pollution in the neighboring states which were situated at the border around in California and other states, and their farming, agriculture, property, these things got damaged due to suspended particulate matter. And then United States filed a case for compensation against Canada, and at that time doctrine of sovereignty was reaffirmed by the arbitration tribunal, and it was held that each country in this world has a sovereign right to exploit their natural resources which are situated within their geographical boundaries. But while exercising their sovereign right to use the natural resources, they must be careful that no harm or no damage is caused to the neighboring states. So from here, the doctrine of sovereignty was recognized, reiterated, but with a clause, with a provision, responsibility, that while exercising one's sovereign right, these should be exercised in such a way so as not to cause any damage or harm to the neighboring states. And friends, this was the era of conservation, when the countries, the states were more committed to conserve the natural resources. And after Second World War, with the establishment of United Nations, most of the colonies got independence. In the wake of independence, now they turned their economic pattern from agriculture or other patterns to industrialist pattern. And in this wake of industrialization, they caused too much pollution. And the seeds of modern environmental law are based in these three or four works. These are shown on your screen. The Silent Spring. And this is the question which is mostly asked in the whenever we conduct the test at the international level for specialization in environmental law in PhD and LLM. So which is the first work, Silent Spring? The distinction of this Silent Spring 1962 by Rachel Carson was, it shown the impact of DDT in the farming and agriculture activities on the birds population as well as on the food chain and soil pollution. Then Paul Ehrlich's work, The Population Bomb. Then Garrett Hardin's The Tragedy of Commons. Commons means the common property, common heritage of mankind, moon, planets, earth, oceans. And then the Club of Rome limits to growth, means the industrialized country, means the north of this globe had already developed. And the other countries, the developing world and underdeveloped world, has yet to develop because they got independence just 20 or 30 years back. So they were now moving very speedily on the path of industrialization, but the some literary works, eminent research work in these developed countries and Scandinavian countries presented the harsh realities of development, that this development may also lead to our destruction. Therefore, United Nations attraction was drawn towards this fact that Universal Declaration of Human Rights did not cover any clause on environment protection. And the literature evoked in shown in the last slide, this literature evolved the idea that every action carried out by a person or a state will have a profound effect on another. The global community realized that mere state actions were inappropriate to deal with environmental problems. Because in UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, environment was not given that kind of significance which it had to be given. And it was left to the mercy of the states to decide, to formulate, to strategize their environmental policies. And in the backdrop of this, it was decided that now there is a need to initiate international efforts to mitigate these problems. And this evolution of anthropocentric approach, which was highly industrialized, this evolution can be traced back from the idea of global action towards environment protection, not only in Stockholm Conference, but also in United Nations General Assembly Resolution 2398 of 1967. At that time, United Nations General Assembly decided that we should bring environment under the banner of United Nations, and we should go not for the two nations or regional, but a global, in which all the members of United Nations can participate in a conference. From here, the United Nations Conference on Human Environment, this idea was conceived. And the seeds of this idea are lying in this important observation of Rachel Carson's The Silent Spring, that, to quote, "Man's attitude towards nature is today critically important simply because we have now acquired a fateful power to alter and destroy nature." Friends, emphasis applied on this expression, fateful power to alter and destroy nature. But man is a part of nature, and his war against nature is inevitably a war against himself. But we are challenged, as mankind has never been challenged before, to prove our maturity and our mastery, not of nature, but on ourselves. And against this backdrop, the United Nations Conference on Human Environment, in abbreviation, UNCHE, it evolved the idea to conduct a UN level conference in 1972. And that's why the conference continued from 5th June 1972 to 14th June. And every year we celebrate World Environment Day on 5th June. The main idea behind this conference was to create a basis for comprehensive considerations within the domain of United Nations to address the problems of human environment, and to focus the attention of all the governments of the world and the public opinion in various countries on the importance of the problem. And it was convinced, it was resolved, that there is need to address the environmental issues, not only at national level, but regional level and at international level, in order to limit and, wherever possible, eliminate the impairment of human environment, and in order to protect and improve the natural surroundings in the interest of man, and to give it a common outlook and direction. So this was the main idea behind organizing the United Nations Conference on Human Environment. And I hope, if the people have focused on this word, why the word human environment is being used. So this is what we have to understand. The purpose is because the man, in the wake of his scientific and technological development, has acquired the power, capability to transform his surroundings. And the man has been kept at the focal point, central point, because it is not the other living creatures which have transformed the environment. If the environment has been deteriorated, that is deteriorated due to two reasons, either natural or man-made. Therefore, man had been kept at the focal point of this universal effort. And then, therefore, the expression is human environment, and it is to indicate the inalienable relationship between man and nature. So it is not only the man who affects nature, but nature also affects man, his health, his spiritual, economic, social, and family perspectives and life. And the most important aspect which we will have to appreciate in this backdrop, friends, I had pointed out that few countries had already developed, and many countries had yet to develop. The whole globe was divided into two parts, North and South. We are falling in South. Means the South of the globe was underdeveloped because it was ruled by North, Britain and Portuguese, French. They ruled over continents. And when North floated the idea, if you remember, this work was the work I referred in these four works. These works belong to which countries? North or South? I think you can have the ideas. Because basically, these, if you are showing the impact of DDT on bird population and on the food chain, certainly the DDT at that time, because the product of industrialization and agriculture in on industrialist pattern, more consumption, more production, and then population boom, and then tragedy of the commons, means common heritage of the mankind, oceans, glaciers, and then high seas. All these are the properties of mankind. Not only the present generation, not only the past generation, but of the future generations who have yet to born as well. So these properties belong commonly to all. So limits to growth, who had already grown. So in fact, these four works belong to developed countries. And the whole world was divided into North and South. The North was consisted of about 41 countries who were developed, and about 153 countries had yet to develop. So there were three classes: developed, developing, and underdeveloped. And when we talk about South, South always looked at this UN General Assembly's Resolution 2398. I have shown you here. In the last line, you can witness the resolution number 2398, when it was resolved by the General Assembly of United Nations to address the environment, not only at the regional or national, but at the international level. So in this resolution, when this resolution was moved in General Assembly, South looked at the intentions of North with the suspicion that how this environment phenomena now came on the agenda item when it had not been put in agenda item since the establishment of United Nations. Neither it was in UN Charter nor it is in UDHR. Then how this agenda of protecting the environment now came in the hit list? Whether it is to exploit them, whether it is to always make them subordinate in terms of economic development. And South of the globe was in favor of equality. They said, we now, you had already developed, we have yet to develop. And in wake of human rights, which have been recognized in UDHR, ICCPR, ICESCR, these cultural, civil, political rights and the various covenants, because the governments had to fulfill the responsibilities to make these human rights available to their masses. And the millions were suffering from poverty. Therefore, industrialization was need of the hour. And if the industrialization is promoted, now you have put the cap of environment on our head that we cannot promote our industrialization because we have to protect the environment. This is the reason due to which the suspicion of South was intensified towards North. They were already facing the pressure of balancing the needs, basic needs of population in developing countries. And if you remember, India at that time was also facing political upheavals, economic upheavals, and a famine, and in most of the parts of India, and the food was less. So that's why then they, at the time of government led by Indira, invited the scientists from Denmark, and their inputs resulted into Green Revolution. So this is the whole background against which this movement started. Now the question is, had we been discussing this subject 100 years before, it would have been known as international law on conservation. Or we have been discussing this subject from 1972 to 1992, this subject would have been known better as international environmental law. But after 1992, this subject started to be known in some of the parts of the world as international law on sustainable development. How this came into being, these are various conventions, because I have also to show you that how this international law evolved. So these are various conventions: United Nations Conference on Human Environment at Stockholm, I had already given you a brief introduction. Then Vienna Convention for the Protection of Ozone Layer, 1985, followed by various protocols. And it was followed by Basel Convention on the Control of Transboundary Movements of Hazardous Waste and Their Disposal, 1989. Then Rio, 1992. One thing has to be kept remembered, that in each decade, and in second year of each decade has been marked as an year by United Nations to take into account that whatever they resolved 10 years before, whether what is the progress on those resolutions. Suppose United Nations Conference on Human Environment occurred in 1972. In 1982, UNEP was created. In 1992, Rio Declaration. In 2002, World Summit on Sustainable Development. So after every 10 years, and in the second year of each decade, we have to take stock of what is the journey, what are the milestones we have covered so far under the aegis of United Nations. And Rio Conference, United Nations Conference on Environment and Development, is known for 5 items. One is Rio Declaration, shown at your point 4 at your screen. Rio Declaration consisting of 27 principles. Agenda 21. Agenda 21 was adopted by the whole humanity, that how humanity will enter into 21st century. Then United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, which will also address the emission of greenhouse gases, industrialization, and all of these things. And fourth was Convention on Biological Diversity. And fifth is Forest Principles. These 5 documents were adopted at Rio in United Nations Conference on Environment and Development. Then, now we, after discussing this whole scenario, after Rio, I had already shared with you in third slide, that after Rio, Johannesburg, World Summit on Sustainable Development, then Rio 20, 2012, then Paris 2015. Now, against this whole scenario, if we look at the national perspectives of environmental jurisprudence, friends, under Article 252 of Indian Constitution, the Parliament of India can frame a law on any subject which is of even state list. Now, if you remember on your screen, the year of passing of Water Act is shown 1974. And there in 1972, the Government of India has ratified and was a signatory of Stockholm Conference, So the resolutions were also adopted by Government of India, and in order to honor its commitment being a signatory of an international agreement, it Parliament of India passed a legislation on the subject falling in the state list. Therefore, Water Act was passed in 1974, after 2 years of Stockholm. Water is the subject falling in state list. The purpose of this act is to prevent and control the pollution generated by the industrial waste. Please mind, there are two words, prevention and control. What is the need to use these two words? Prevention is for future activities. Control is for present activities. The industries which are creating pollution, these have to be put under a control. The industries which may create the pollution or which are in the pipeline of establishment, those will have to be prevented. Friends, then came 1981 Air Act, because slowly they recognized that the industries are not causing only water pollution or soil pollution or groundwater contamination. Rather, the industrial waste and suspended particulate matter also generate air pollution. And then they passed Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981. And it is not only in India, but throughout the world that step by step laws were being passed. On other hand, Wildlife Protection Act, Forest Conservation Act 1972, and these were 1980 were passed. So it was realized by the governments around the world that instead of passing one by one environmental sectoral legislations, we should go for passing a comprehensive law that is called Framework Environmental Law. And the Framework Environmental Law of India is Environment Protection Act. So environment includes so many things, and the interrelationship between and among those things, whether it is water, air, soil, mountain, hills, and groundwater, and living organisms, non-living organisms, biotic and abiotic factors, relationship between and among them. All these constitute the environment. And now, the government of India, as well as other governments in developing countries, realize that there is need to enact a comprehensive legislation under one roof, that is Environment Protection Act 1986. So I would also like to share with all the audience that Water Act, Air Act, these are known as sectoral legislation. Please mind, sectoral legislations, environmental jurisdictions. Environment Protection Act is known as Framework Environmental Law. Means that is an umbrella legislation. And when we entered in new millennium, we passed Biological Diversity Act 2002. Why it was passed? If you remember, here you can look at the last line, Convention on Biological Diversity. In order to honor the commitment and its obligation, the Government of India passed Biological Diversity Act 2002. And here we are proud to claim that India was one of the 12 mega diversities recognized at that time, who was first among the countries having taken the initiative to pass this legislation, Biological Diversity Act. And India is emerged as biological diversity leader. Why? Because if you remember, during 1990s to 2000, India's biological wealth was stolen by one of the countries by patenting on neem, turmeric, and basmati. Therefore, India immediately, to prevent such bio theft and bio piracy activities, enacted Biological Diversity Act, followed by National Green Tribunal 2010. So we have seen so far the discussion which had taken place, how international agreements shaped environmental jurisprudence, how national legislations shaped environmental jurisprudence, and now the third aspect we will discuss, how judicial means precedents. Though we had also discussed the tribunals award in 1893, in 1938 Prel Smelters case, so how environmental jurisprudence is enriched by another source of law, that is precedent. So we have a few of the landmark cases, which shaped the environmental jurisprudence of the country. Govind Singh versus Shanti Sahu. In most of the books of environmental law in India, the most of the authors have mentioned that Ratlam Municipality versus Vardichand is the first case. Please correct yourself. The authors had different opinion and I have different findings. It was Govind Singh versus Shanti Sahu. The case was decided on in 1978 under the same section, section 133 of CRPC, when air pollution was caused by the discharge of smoke by a chimney of a bakery. And then L.K. Kulwar versus State of Rajasthan. Each citizen has a right to know what the state is doing. And then on solid waste management, we have B.L. Vadera's, Almitra Patel's. This is, I will share the screen. And recent phenomena, recent development is Salamalla Reddy and others versus State of Andhra Pradesh. This case was filed in 2013 at NGT Southern Zone, Chennai. And you will be surprised to believe, when I had to analyze this case, the title of the case was in 46 pages. Please mind, title of the case was in 46 pages. Means 700 parties were there. About 400 parties were as petitioner and 300 parties were as respondent. And the case was concerning the most burning issue of the present day. How to dispose of pharmaceutical and how to control pollution caused by pharmaceutical industry and contain it under the doctrine of polluter pay, precautionary principle, doctrine of public trust, doctrine of sustainable development, doctrine of intergenerational equity. These many doctrines which are based on our values, because now I am drawing your attention towards the values. Values means these values formed our customs, and customs are also an important source of formation of laws. So doctrine of intergenerational equity, intragenerational equity, these are two doctrines. Sometimes the students use it interchangeably. Intrageneration means within the generation. Intergeneration means between the generations. So intragenerational and intergenerational disparities have to be curbed. We have to protect, we have to conserve the natural resources, not only for ourselves or our contemporaries living in other parts of the world, but also for the future generation. So this is intra and intergeneration. Then comes polluter pay. The polluter has to pay. Then comes precautionary principle, doctrine of public trust, common but differentiated responsibility principle. So there are about 10 principles which have been culminated, which have emerged as a part of environmental jurisprudence. And the recent case which I would like to share with the students is Divya Pharmacy versus Union of India, which is a very landmark case on biological diversity. One of our leading brand, Patanjali, that has been convicted to pay the compensation and sharing the benefits of their turnover they earned on the basis of using the biological resources of the state of Uttarakhand. And this is, I would like to take you all towards conclusion. why in present century, present times, it has started its journey as international law on conservation. In 21st century and second decade, we are talking about agenda on sustainable development 2030. If you look at new education policy, it's page 1, para 2, page number 38, page number 39, page number 52. At these pages, the government of India has referred Agenda for Sustainable Development and SDG, Sustainable Development Goals. So friends, this is principle 27 of Rio, due to which I share with you that after 1992, the law has changed its nomenclature and now it is known as International Law on Sustainable Development. Let me quote, states and people shall cooperate in good faith and in a good spirit of partnership in the fulfillment of the principles embodied in this declaration and in the further development of international law in the field of sustainable development. So all this is, I wanted to give you a bird's eye view of what, how international environmental law emerged through conservational arbitrational awards to conserve the natural resources, where in 1893 between United Kingdom versus United States. Then doctrine of sovereignty was recognized in 1938 through trial smelters case arbitration. Then in Rachel Carson's work, The Silent Spring, the spring was silent, there was no bird, birds were extinguished, those vanished, and the spring was silent, which compelled Rachel Carson to conduct the study why the spring is silent. And later it was acknowledged that due to the use of DDT and its contaminants, its nutrients in the food chain, soil, the birds have extinguished. Similarly, it is the case of South Asia also. There are 10 species of vultures in the world. Three species which were known only in South Asia, those have extinguished due to the use of diclofenic sodium in veterinary drugs. Because what vultures do, what is their food, you understand, the animal carcass. And when animal carcass were containing the residues of diclofenic sodium, those collapsed. And now three species of the world have extinguished. So we have to develop sustainably without compromising the need of future generations to use the natural resources, to give them the access to the natural resources. And I usually end my presentation whenever I talk on environmental law by referring Article 51AG of Indian Constitution. That says, it is duty of each citizen of India to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, wildlife, and to have compassionate approach towards living creatures. So with these words, I would like to quote the message I had for present as well as future generations, drafted by myself. We are the generation, predecessors of which were warned by the nature as to the mode and effects of blind growth. We are the generation, having realized first that it is not possible to have a healthy planet in the absence of socio-economic just world. We are the generation, having identified the true and realistic meaning of the sustainable development, reversing the focus mere from economic growth of individual or individual nation to equitable growth. We are the generation which will prefer to work not for the extinction of life on this earth, but for preservation. We are the generation being fully acquainted with the fact that the advent of science and technology has empowered us to solve our environmental problems with its judicious use.
Hello.
And we are the generation being sensitized to the truth that nature is not only to be consumed but has also to be enjoyed. We are the generation fully conscious of Saint Exupery's word of wisdom. All these, the world's riches are not something what we own, but something we have on loan from our children. So friends, we are the generation who will not be forgiven by the posterity for our sins, not our crimes, had we not taken due step in the right direction. With this belief that we have the future in our hands, our generation owes a high sense of duties and acts of wisdom for correction. Unquote, Tarun Arora. Thankful to all of you for your patience and careful listening. I would welcome the queries, questions. Email is also there and the time is now open. Over to Belsa.
Dr. Sab, I think, thank you very much for your very innovative speech on environmental jurisprudence. I think our students have been benefited to great extent. And I'll ask Navjot ma'am if there are queries in the chat. So please put the questions.
Smriti, you can continue with the queries. Thank
Hello.
You so much, sir, for such
Hello.
An amazing and informative session. I have certain questions from the side of students which I would like to ask. The first question is, should trees have rights? If yes, how you determine the scope of granting legal person status of trees?
Trees?
Yes, sir.
No, so far the law is silent on this point, and the recently two judgments I would like to quote here. One is Muhammad Saleem versus State of UP, in which Ganga River was recognized as a person, but next day the judgment was stayed by the Supreme Court. And second is in 2018, Karnail Singh versus State of Haryana, where Punjab and Haryana High Court recognized animals as persons and citizens of India as the loco parentis and loco guardian of the animals. So far as recognition means recognition of trees as a person is concerned, law is silent on this point, and it has not come to the notice of myself that ever any literature, even in foreign countries where the trees have been recognized as person. Trees are the properties of state, and we are the trustees of future generation. We have to perform our responsibility under the doctrine of public trust. Personality status is not accorded to trees.
Thank you, sir. Next question is, what is DPSP related to environmental jurisprudence? Is
Sorry?
There any definition of water pollution under Water Act 19? Is there any definition of water pollution under Water Act 1947?
1974 Water Act. And the question is not of water pollution's definition. The definition is of pollutant. And what is pollutant? Pollutant can be a solid, liquid, or any other substance which contaminates and deteriorates the qualities of properties of water.
Yes. So the next question is, what is potential role of animals / wildlife in welfare in environment legislation?
The question is a little bit, I can say, we have to reframe the question. Will you please repeat?
So the question written is, what is the potential role of animal in environmental legislation?
It is not a question of animals. It is a question of mankind. That's why the conference was organized and the title is Human Environment. The man has to be kept at the central. We have not to make it confused. Animals cannot go on the mankind. Man has to go on. man has to regulate, man has to conserve. And even in Biological Diversity Act, the microorganisms which have to be taken care of, because these play a very substantial role in natural equilibrium and carrying out the life on this planet. So it is not the question of role of animals. Role of animal welfare laws is a different thing. Role of animals, I doubt that either the question may be mistyped or typographical error. The question is only of the mankind. Mankind, this species, man has been kept, has to be kept, and will be kept as a central figure in regulating the environment. That's why even United Nations say, United Nations Conference on Human Environment. It is either the man who will affect the environment or environment which will affect the man.
So the last question is, are there any national targets or legal requirements for increasing the use of renewable energy?
Yeah, targets. Recently, India has submitted its report during COVID-19 lockdown period. Those are VNRC report, voluntarily national contribution report to the United Nations, and that is submitted every year in pursuance of the target of Agenda for Sustainable Development. Because India is also one of the signatory on Agenda on Sustainable Development 2030, where we have the whole humanity, not only present generation, but also for future generations on their behalf. As their trustee, we have adopted 17 SDG, 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And every 2 years, we send them our contribution. So this year's contribution report has already been submitted to United Nations. That is VNCR, Voluntarily National Contribution Report. So that report, the government of India itself resolves and commits that we are going to reduce carbon emission by this much of the amount, this much percentage. We are going to reduce other greenhouse gases emission in the air by this much. So voluntarily national contribution is recognized. They resolve it because at international level, there is no body which has any kind of fixed than any obligations that each country has to do this. So it is the mutual agreements reached at by consensus at IDA.
So there is a one-liner question, if you permit me to ask. Who is the chairman of Stockholm Declaration?
Maurice Strong. Maurice Strong.
Thank and you so at much.
At that time, the United Nations Secretary General was Kurt Waldheim, whose quotations I usually refer in each lecture, but that is on only environment protection, not on law. So the Maurice Strong organized that conference of 1972, as well as Rio Declaration was also organized by the same fellow.
Thank you so much, sir, for clearing all our doubts. Now, as we move towards the end of this informative session, I would like Navjot ma'am to extend a vote of thanks to our guest of honor.
I would first like to ask Bhavesh sir and Behel sir if you want to add something, or we can move towards the vote of thanks.
Yeah, it's okay, ma'am. You can end the webinar now.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you so much, sir. Sir, I would like you to know, first of all, that we have DME Eco Club, and I'm taking care of that club. So we really want you to come to our college, or we can have some activities soon in collaboration with you, because the way you have taken today's webinar, it has been a learning thing for me as well, and I've learned a lot of things, new judgments, and few of the things which I was missing while, you know, I have taught the students environment law. With these, we can move towards the vote of thanks now. I would firstly like to propose a hearty vote of thanks to the distinguished speaker, Professor Dr. Tarun Arora, Dean, School of Legal Studies, Central University of Punjab. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing time out of your busy schedule and delivering a productive and knowledgeable address. We are really enlightened with your knowledge and presence. I would like to express my profound gratitude to our Director General, Dean and Head of Academics, School of Law, for their moral support and constant guidance. I mention my deepest sense of appreciation and would place on record my hearty thanks to Ms. Smriti Bali, fifth year student of law at DME, for hosting the webinar with the utmost perfection. Finally, most important, I would like to thank the wonderful audience who have actively participated in the session and made it a grand success. With these warm words and a kind message, we move towards the end of today's session. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I will take 1 minute, ma'am. Since
you mentioned
about your activities going on in your campus. So first, I would like to bring to your kind notice that now the government of India requires all of the higher educational institutions to follow sustainable development practices in their campuses. And I have also been the part of one committee to look into it. And now as a sustainable development campus, SDG ranking shall take place. Abhi tak aapne ranking suni thi, NIRF ranking, NAC ranking. Now, the government of India let this COVID phase get over. It had already launched its policy on Satat SDG ranking, in which we people will have to look at the means Belsa be sitting, your management may also be conveyed, that we have to look at green building, landscaping, and then green catering, green parking, green transportation, green event management. There are many means expectations of the government from the educational institutions, especially higher educational institution, members of the society, by which suppose we organize events in our university. We never use disposable bottles, man. We always use these glasses. Fine. And similarly, the banners which once we publish, those banners should not have any year or date. The function, if it is convocation, if it is cultural function, it should be without date, without year, so that it can be repeatedly used. Similarly, paperless communication. And in each of the seminar and conference and webinar, I show that fine, this is a notice board. Might be that it has to be displayed on the notice board. When the date is over, the notice was sent by you or any Chandra Prabhu Jain College for inviting me or sending my team in law festival. And when the notice is expired, I get it from the notice board and I start it doing for my rough work. So this is how little steps can help us to make our campus sustainable campus. And we can contribute in the movement to endorse think globally, act locally. So similarly, when we purchase the things, Belsa is sitting, the senior administration people can see that AC, sir, I would like to show you. You can see 5-star rating. Being purchase officer of this university, when I was the policy maker, I made the policy that whenever we buy anything, we have to buy 5-star rating certified by Bureau of Energy Efficiency so that our electricity consumption is less. Similarly, our building has been rated as the best building of the nation. Central University of Punjab building, our future campus is rated as Griha 5-star rating. Only 2 campuses are in the country. One is Central University of Punjab, Bathinda. Second is Manipal University, Jaipur. Those who have been accorded 5-star rating by Green Rating Integrated Habitat Assessment. Griha is an agency which will evaluate, which will give you the accreditation by looking at your building, whether it is using the natural air, natural energy, airflow, ventilation, all the things in consonance with the green building norms. And similar is the waste management campuses, waste management practices in your campus. So we have many things. Certainly, I would like to visit after the situation gets normal. And thankful to Naresh sir for sitting throughout to spare.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. It's a really learning experience hearing you. Thank you again.
Absolutely, sir. I definitely agree with Dean, sir. It has been a great experience, and not only for the students, but also for the faculties. And we'll surely take up the advices which you have given. You've given me a lot of ideas, and I know what I have to do for the coming year.
Sorry, but I had to run so many, too fast because I had less time and too much material was there. And the 55 slides, I just cut short only in 22 slides.
Short and crisp, but I could understand the international, national and everything, the role of judiciary, everything was covered. So thank you so much, sir. And we really want you to be here at DME soon after the COVID.
Thank you.
Namaskar, sir.